Now to the American media, which is in the throes of a Democratic National Convention. And there have been some wild moments as journalists make every conceivable move to promote their favorite candidate. But one of the weirdest moments was when CNN's Dana Bash made this abstract argument that men who supported Kamala Harris didn't have high testosterone, and somehow that was a good thing.
But they are doing so in trying to put forward male figures, Tim Walz being one of them, Doug Emhoff last night, who can speak to men out there who might not be the sort of testosterone-laden, you know, gun-toting kind of guy who wants to listen to Hulk Hogan and the kind of players that came out of the RNC, or might want to listen to that, but also, in addition, understand that it's okay in 2024 to be a man comfortable in his own skin who supports a woman. And that's something that they really are trying to work on with male voters beyond the base.
Abby, we were talking about this earlier, yeah. The different definitions of masculinity in 2024,
right.
And what we saw at the Trump convention, which was, as you know, somebody, I forget exactly who said it, testosterone-y.
Nothing screams I hate masculinity like demonizing a key hormone men literally need to be healthy. It prompted this brilliant headline by Fox. Dems mocked as low-T soy boys after CNN anchor says DNC appeals to the opposite of testosterone-laden men. Now, I have no idea where CNN finds these people, but there's actually more. Remember when journalists thought their job was to ask tough questions, probe policies, and hold power to account? Well, CNN's Erin Burnett certainly doesn't. Watch her ask about whether it is smart for Harris to keep avoiding tough interviews.
Shulman, you've interviewed Kamala Harris.
Yep, a few times.
All right. Everybody's come on your radio show. Everybody has to come on your radio show. She hasn't done a big interview in a while here, and certainly not since announcing. Are you going to talk to her soon? What do you think she should do? Or does she do better to ignore all those calls to talk and just keep doing what she's doing?
I think what she's been doing has worked because, you know, what she's been doing is hitting the ground. And I think, you know, sometimes we forget about the ground game in this digital era that we're in, this era of interviews. Sometimes, you know, not sometimes, all the time when you're actually on the ground shaking hands, you know, kissing babies, actually touching people, that goes a long way. And I think she'll get the interviews after the DNC. But, you know, this week I think she got bigger fish to fry, like going out there tomorrow and knocking a home run speech out the park.
Christy, let's start with you. I mean, some of the coverage has been absolutely nauseating while these journalists just sit around and they're all nodding in furious agreement with each other about how testosterone is somewhat bad and right-wing. I don't know how that's possible, but what do you make of this?
Well, I personally like men who have testosterone. Jack, Ollie, I think that going on national TV at the DNC saying Democrat men are beta men or SIG for Sigma men, as the Gen Z say these days, is probably putting all the Democrat men into a category that they don't really want to be in. And what's going to be really interesting is when they have to come out and defend that they actually have testosterone, that they actually are alphas. So who knows where they were going with that conversation. And I've just wanted to pick up as well with Kamala Harris not doing any interviews. There's one thing that no Democrat-leaning commentator has said, which is she is copying Donald Trump. This is a man who avoided the mainstream press, who elevated himself to a huge cohort of his base by utilising social media and his own channels and avoiding the mainstream press. She has obviously said, well, that worked for him. I'm doing it. But no one wants to call her out on it. No Democrat-leaning commentator wants to say it.
Yeah, it's such a good point. And Oliver, I think it does expose the fact that a lot of these more traditional outlets, they don't have as much influence. And candidates can bypass the traditional mainstream apparatus, which used to be so crucial. There's never been a point in modern political history where you could just not do interviews and still get prominence, still talk directly to people and your base. But my problem with it, and Christy has touched on this, is the journalists shouldn't be advocating for that, because part of the function of a democratic society is you can push back, you can probe, you can expose hypocrisy. Yeah. And so the access seems to have dissipated as well.
Yeah, I could not understand any journalist being a cheerleader for saying, oh, yeah, I don't want to talk to you. No, that's great. Just keep hitting the ground. We'll just take your pre-prepared clips and look at your social media and we'll use that. That's not the role of what any of us do, Jack. And I reckon we're at a tipping point. This election is fascinating for that. Because if we see two candidates here who barely give a radio interview, a television interview, whether they sit down and have a discussion and they can waltz their way through the election later this year, then that is going to be a bad day for democracy. And Anthony Albanese and Peter Dutton will be looking at this and thinking, well, I don't need to talk to the Australian media as often as I do. And I think, to our Prime Minister's credit and our opposition leader's credit here in Australia, they both use the media and vice versa for interviews. And they are prepared for that, whether it's here on Sky, on 6PR with me, on any of our media organisations around Australia. So this is a real tipping point for the future of our industry. And if you've got journalists cheerleading, saying, yeah, walk the ground, don't talk the talk, we've got big problems with our industry. And those American journos need to think about what they're doing.